It gives me great pleasure to introduce Dr. Madhuri Koti, and her talk is entitled, Let's Talk About Sex Differences in Cancer.
Hello, everyone. If blood in urine is a sign of bladder cancer, how will women know? Because they see blood in their urine during their monthly periods. I was quite surprised to get this question from a very young school-aged girl. Last year, I volunteered at the annual Bladder Cancer Canada Awareness Walk here in Kingston. I felt motivated to join the walk after meeting Jerry, a 72-year-old bladder cancer survivor who got diagnosed with bladder cancer and had his bladder removed after diagnosis of a late-stage bladder cancer. Jerry's daughter was helping at this event, and she introduced me to this young girl who had the question, a question that often doesn't occur to many of us adults. The explanation I gave her was most women who get diagnosed with bladder cancer are older when they have stopped getting their periods. So it's not very difficult to notice something abnormal happening to their bodies. I also told her that the symptoms are very similar to a urinary tract infection, which is very common in females, and for which women generally don't go to a urologist, which adds to the delay in diagnosis. My name is Madhuri, and I'm a cancer researcher at Queen's University. I study how cancer cells talk to, or rather, trick and tire out the cells of our immune system. And what can we do to rescue this exhausted and tired immune system to fight cancer? I've always been fascinated by the miraculous ways our immune system works. Very early in our lives, our immune system undergoes special fitness training so that it's ready to fight disease-causing microbes or even abnormally behaving cells of our own bodies. It's like an army made up of several different types of cells, basically soldiers, each with their simple names such as a T cell, a B cell, an NK cell, or others. All these cells have their unique or overlapping roles to play. They constantly patrol our bodies and sense danger. If they encounter any, they fight it off and make sure that danger does not return. Or if it returns, they remember to fight even better and sooner. This is mostly a team effort, and often a relay race, accomplished by some cells that are at the front line and fight early, and some that come in late and stay longer. A fact that is not as widely acknowledged is that females and males have many differences in the numbers and behaviors of their immune cells. Our biological sex as a female or a male is assigned to us by a specific pair of chromosomes within all the cells of our body, except the sperm and the egg. Females have two X chromosomes in all their cells, whereas males have one X and a Y chromosome. The X chromosome is quite rich. It contains more than 1,000 genes, versus the Y chromosome, which has less than 100 genes. When it comes to the genes that make our immune system work, again, the X chromosome is the winner. In fact, females have a double dose of some of these immune fitness genes, which is why they are able to fight infections better than males. This has been known for a long time in the case of flu and many other diseases, and even cancer. And most recently reminded to us by the COVID-19 pandemic, where we saw males experiencing more severe disease compared to females. Cancer journey begins when cells of our own body forget to stop multiplying and grow uncontrollably to make small or large tumors. Our immune system tries hard to stop them from growing and making small or large communities, which is why it's an unfriendly neighborhood in the beginning. But that can often fail, which is when we start experiencing symptoms and diagnosis is made. Urinary bladder is a small pouch that is located in the lower abdomen of both females and males, although the surroundings are different between males and females. And the wall of the bladder is slightly thinner in females compared to males. Cancer of the bladder can be caused by smoking or long-term exposure to environmental carcinogens, some industrial chemicals. Tumors generally start forming in the inner lining of the bladder and spread through the muscles into a body if they are not detected early. Blood and urine is a suspected sign of bladder cancer for both females and males. At the time of diagnosis, 75% of bladder cancer cases are at early stages, and some have advanced to the muscle. Bladder cancer is also one of the most expensive cancers to treat and quite management intensive, as it requires lifetime surveillance. The average age of bladder cancer diagnosis is 73 years, an age when the signs of the weakening immune system are quite noticeable. Imagine not having a bladder at that age, or making frequent visits to the urologist to get the inside of your bladder checked. Not a very comfortable procedure. With the aging population, it is expected that in the next 25 years, there'll be a significant rise in the incidence of bladder cancer. Despite this estimated increase, research on bladder cancer remains most underfunded, especially in Canada. While bladder cancer is 3 to 4 times more common in males compared to females, it's mostly diagnosed at more advanced stages in females, and often more lethal than males. You'll be surprised to know that sex differences in bladder cancer incidence and outcomes have been known for a very long time. However, they still remain to be fully integrated and explored in research and clinical practice. An interesting observation made from a European survey conducted a couple of years ago showed that only 14% adults knew that bladder cancer is more common in males and somewhat more lethal in females. Almost 50% adults did not know such differences existed. Now that's not very surprising, because advocacy for bladder cancer is not as dominant as it should be. In my opinion, this is also because many patients are older, and their lifelong treatment journey is very tiring in itself. While the advanced stage bladder cancer is treated using radiation or chemotherapy or even bladder removal surgery, early stage bladder cancer has a very unique treatment. The urologist first removes the bladder tumor. A few weeks after, the patient predicted to be at a higher risk of recurrence is treated using BCG, which is given directly into the bladder. BCG, as you know, is a vaccine. It's a live bacterial preparation that millions of infants across the world receive as a single dose to prevent tuberculosis. Bladder cancer patients receive multiple repeated doses and 300 to 400 times more bacteria over 1 to 3 year period. BCG basically boosts your immune system response and helps mop up the leftover cancer cells after surgery and alerts the cells of our immune system so they are ready to fight any returning cancer. This practice-changing treatment, now followed across the world, was first initiated here at Queen's University 50 years ago by a urologist named Dr. Alvaro Morales, who is here with us today. It has been over 45 years that this treatment is being followed all over the world, because many patients do benefit from it. Unfortunately, it does not work really well for more than 50% of patients who experience early recurrence or progression to an advanced disease. Surprisingly, many female patients do not experience benefits from BCG immunotherapy. I've always been curious to know what is different between the immune response of cancer patients who do well after getting a certain treatment versus those who do not. It's like solving a puzzle. And the first step is to take a detailed look at the tumor from patients, because it often tells you stories of the long fight between the cancer and the immune system, although as a snapshot. This is done using a technology that paints the tumors with different colors to look for all the cells, including immune cells, within the tumor. When you look at all this together, we see either scattered varieties of immune cells or groups of them almost looking like celestial constellations of stars, with different numbers, locations, and patterns. The prominent features from tumors from patients who do well versus those who do not help us develop tests that can be used for predicting the disease journey or altering the treatment. Almost 10 years ago, when I started my career as an independent scientist, the question my urologist colleague brought to me was, what could be different between the immune makeup of tumors from patients who do well following BCG therapy versus those who do not? For the first 5 years, this was the only question we were trying to answer. We never assigned a sex to the tumors that we were studying, and never considered that since some of these tumors are coming from female patients and some are coming from male patients, differences must exist. So I brought this idea of looking at sex differences between males and females in bladder cancer to my urology and pathology colleagues here at Queen's University. With their help, we then conducted an analysis of tumors from over 300 patients who were treated here at Kingston General Hospital, using the same technology to paint tumors to look for the numbers or presence of immune cells that may have arrived at some point when the cancer journey started, and see whether there are differences between tumors from males and females. This exploration led to some very interesting findings. First, we were able to validate what was known before, what others had reported, in terms of the numbers of immune cells, more number of immune cells coming in tumors from patients who did not do well and who did not respond to BCG immunotherapy. A major novel finding from this study was a type of immune cell called a B cell that is known to make antibodies, for example, when you get a COVID-19 vaccine, was not only higher in numbers, but also present in groups inside the tumors from patients who either experienced early recurrence or did not respond to BCG immunotherapy. This was quite surprising. It appeared that a lot of these Bs came close to the cancer cells, but they probably got tired fighting with them. Quite interestingly, this was more pronounced in tumors from female patients. This was also interesting because females have inherently more number of these B cells. Another interesting fact is genes that are responsible for the main helpers of these B cells, they are located on the X chromosome. We thought there could be a link here that can explain the poor cancer journey experienced by female patients. Of course, this would also hold true for male patients whose tumors had more number of these B cells. The next question was, how do we test this? Or how do we prove this? Knowing that the cancer journey to diagnosis is almost 10 to 20 years, and the information that we were getting from the tumors was basically snapshots. Mice are not humans, but they are the best living models available to us in the lab to test our hypothesis. Very importantly, there are several similarities between the immune systems in mice and humans, including sex differences. So we took female and male mice that were older and exposed them to a carcinogen that to mimic cigarette smoke-induced bladder cancer development. We then treated them with BCG, the same dose and same schedule of BCG for both the groups of female and male mice. And alongside, tested whether removing these B cells during BCG treatment helped at all. To our excitement, cancer-like features were significantly reduced in mice that had B cells removed during their BCG treatment. Not very surprisingly, but adding to our excitement, this effect was more pronounced in female mice than male mice. These findings are still at their infancy, and there are several aspects of sex differences that we still do not understand. So what does all this mean, and will this ever help improving bladder cancer treatment? Well, I'm hopeful and optimistic that it will. What we learned first was the immune system was quite tired in patients who did not do well, who experienced early recurrence or did not respond to BCG immunotherapy. We also got some answers to our question on why females don't do well after getting BCG treatment or their overall cancer journey. A question for which I do not have an answer: if females and males have differences in their immune response at all ages, should female and male cancer patients be getting the same amount of any immunotherapy? We're just beginning to explore some of these interesting questions in sex differences in blood, in not only in bladder cancer, but that can be applied beyond bladder cancer. Reflecting back on the simple but insightful question asked by the young girl about periods and bladder cancer, I hope research on sex differences will lead to breakthroughs that will help adults of her generation experience early diagnosis and more effective treatments. If you see blood in your urine that is not because of infection or period, consider going to a urologist. Thank you.